from a dark basement in a ghostly haunted dwelling somewhere in the black swamps of Northwest Ohio. This is Swampcast, and I am your host, Arizona Tramp. Well, good evening, good morning, wherever you might be in this world, because we are worldwide now. We can be listened to all over the place, man. I am telling you, you wouldn't believe it. I have got this station listed so many different places all over the world. It's unbelievable. So, let's start off the night like this. I'm not a political show. You know that. But I have to say this about Clinton. I have to put out my opinion about what's going on with little Miss Clinton. They're trying to say that she is a diabetic. She's not a diabetic. I mean pneumonia. I don't know where I was going from here. She doesn't have pneumonia. You know what it's like to have pneumonia. It zaps your energy. It puts you in a bed. You can't have no other choice but to stay in bed or go to a hospital and being taken care of. This crap about her, you know, having pneumonia is nothing but crap. What it is she had a head injury. All right, she had a blood clot. Now she has petite mal seizures. Petite mal seizures are small seizures. They don't make you flop on the floor and go blah, 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 blah. They don't do that. Okay, I know. I used to have it. I used to volunteer at the Epilepsy Foundation in Northwest Ohio. So I know this kind of stuff. And that's what she was doing the other day, getting into the van. People had to help her carry in because she's having a petite mal seizure. Okay, I also think that she has a double. Or she has two doubles. And that's what you saw coming out of the house, was a double. I mean, they pay a person enough money, they'll throw their voice, they'll look like they want them to look in the whole nine yards. Anyway, enough of Clinton. What we need to do, we need to take a walk through the station, okay? We need to take a walk to the station. There's a lot that has changed with Black Swamp Radio. And a shout out to PSN Radio that we're airing live on right now, too. Hi, guys. And thank you, Angel. All right. if you go to programming, when you go down to programming, you're going to see the banners for Swamp Gas and for Notes from the Underground and for Jim Mallard's Fastest Hour in Paranormal Talk Radio, the Mallard Report. All right, those air every single night of the week, and they're replays, and they're good, and it starts at 7 o'clock Eastern and it runs till midnight. If you're not sure of the date and time, because Swamp Gas goes starts at 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time and runs till 2 o'clock. All right, and the rest of the time we play old time radio on the weekends, and we've got indie music, really cool ass sweet indie music. Some of it's pagan, some of it's Christian. It's a mix, as long as it's good. And that rap, I don't care. I mean, there's a little bit of rap thrown in there, but not a whole lot. Now, what you need to do is you scroll down a little bit more and you see these the same banners for the Mallard Report and those from the Underground and stuff. You click those banners, it'll take you to those guys' websites for when they air live. Or you can hear podcasts, it'll take you to the podcast site, what have you. And you scroll down further, you get the thing here that tells you who's going to be on the next show or what's going on. And you scroll down further and you can go to different places. Like, we're on TuneIn, we're on internetradio.com, we're on Google Play, we're iTunes, we are everywhere, I'm telling you. Which brings me to my next thing, man. I don't ask for donations. I don't like to ask for donations, but I have no choice. It started last night. But the long and short of it is the computer that I'm broadcasting on right now died on me today. And I had to take magic and duct tape and put it back together. Literally had to tear it apart, clean it, put it back together. It's done. I'm afraid to turn this thing off ever again because it may never come back on. That, between getting a new computer, and I'm, you know, server payments and whatever else I might need, all donations go strictly for the server, period. I don't spend the money on anything else, you know. And in the past, I've had people help me, you know, but that's really all I want to say, other than the fact that if you want something for a donation, I don't get a whole lot for a donation, but if you want something in return for a donation, go buy a t-shirt, man, or a coffee mug or something like that. You can get to it on the Black Swamp main page. There's the train. And now it's time for Amanda Kern's Swampy News. So I haven't even heard this today, so I got to find out what it sounds like. I know she did a good job. She always does a good job. So here we go.
This is News from the Swamp. I'm Amanda Curran. Another ex-military officer and CIA agent has just come forward, confirming that alien abductions are not only real, but are occurring even more often than the average person would think. Daryl Sims has spent over 38 years studying alien abductions and is now sharing his experiences with the public. Sims says he has conducted countless field research and on-site investigations where he has amassed a collection of alien implants and fluorescence. Research has revealed that the materials used to make the implants are of meteorite origin. Sims also claims that abduction victims often come back with a dermatological scope mark or with implants fixed into their bodies, and explains that aliens often leave some sort of fingerprint on abductees. He says he's also found burn marks and even radiation particles at UFO landing sites. In spite of all this, however, Sim theorizes that aliens have come to Earth to have organizational structure, not unlike human intelligence agencies. In related news, a new video has surfaced showing what many claim is a mothership hidden amongst the clouds traveling across the sky over Peru. According to UFO Sightings Hotspot, an amateur videographer called Marcus was shooting a time-lapse video of clouds passing his city when he claims his camera accidentally filmed a massive alien UFO mothership that emerged from behind cloaking clouds. Many viewers believe that this video does show an artificially constructed structure, which they suggest that the cloaked extraterrestrial craft became visible in the clouds after it decloaked accidentally. While theories have been pouring in, many are comparing this latest UFO sighting to an alleged sighting in July of a 1-kilometer-wide flying saucer hovering over Colombia, where hundreds of onlookers took to social media to post images and videos of the sighting. Check out the video at our Facebook page at Black Swamp Radio and tell us what you think. Most of us have heard the theory that an infinite amount of monkeys, given an infinite amount of time, will eventually come up with the complete works of Shakespeare, which is a philosophical concept not everyone can wrap their heads around. But according to new research, we are now on our way to assisting our primate relatives in making this a reality. A team of neuroscientists and engineers at Stanford University's BioX Research Laboratories has invented mind-reading technology that has given monkeys the ability to type up to 12 words per minute. Electrodes are implanted directly into a user's brain, where brain waves emitted from the motor cortex are detected, which are then analyzed and interpreted by computer algorithms detected by the sensors. While brainwave detecting electrodes have been in use for some time, interpreting those signals has been a difficult task. Researchers had trained laboratory monkeys to type up to 12 words per minute of either Hamlet or the New York Times, using a keyboard to type letters that appear on the screen in front of them. This new technology now allows the monkeys to type words solely using their minds. Researchers say our results demonstrate that this interface may have great promise for use in people. This research is funded and undertaken by the Stanford Brain Machine Interface Initiative and was designed to develop technologies that seamlessly integrate with our minds, while other research institutions have been making similar advances, like an Ohio State University project that allowed a paralyzed man to regain motor control. The only downfall researchers predict for the future is that they cannot quantify the cognitive load of figuring out what words the user is trying to say, as the program does not use an auto-completion like a smartphone does, where it guesses words for you. So while this technology will allow for hands-free typing, humans engaging in actual conversation would likely be much slower than monkeys copying text due to the somewhat arduous task of selecting each individual letter. Check out a video from Stanford University on this breakthrough technology on our Facebook page at Black Swamp Radio. I'm Amanda Curran, news from the swamp.
News from the swamp. Hey, Amanda, I think that sounded pretty good if you ask me. All right, now it's time for our guest, people. I have Eric Cooper. Eric Cooper is a witch. Eric Cooper is also a disabled military veteran, U.S. Army retired. He has a group called Forest Moon Paranormal. He does things, him and his people do things like remote view, and they do astral projection work for ghost hunting. He has his own radio show and a lot of other cool stuff. This is a show that's going to be packed, man, so you need to like chill and listen. Eric, are you there?
I am here.
Thank you so much for being on the show, and welcome. So where do you want to...
Thank you. I love the swamp.
Thank you. Appreciate it much. So where do you want to start, my friend?
Let's start from the beginning.
Go for it.
Let's start from the very beginning. So, I hate this echo. Anyway, so I was in the Army from 89 to 2010. With a 7-month break. And I was a combat medic and a truck mechanic. Both in Moestas. I was in Desert Storm. Actually, I was in Operation Positive Force with the cavalry. Then I was in Somalia in 93. I didn't do anything pagan at that point. And then I was in Balad, Iraq, where I started Desert Moon Grove up. Cool. And that was a pagan group.
Awesome. Oh, go ahead.
In 2001 is actually when I started getting into the pagan political side with the military, because I was in Kitzingen, Germany, and I was switched from one company to another because I needed NCOs in another company. And my first day, my first morning formation, my first sergeant, who, for those that aren't familiar with the military, the first sergeant is the enlisted side that runs, he's the command. And then you got officers, which would be captains, who would run a command for a company level. And my first morning formation, he comes out and verbatim says, if you are a Wiccan or a Satanist, you will not practice in my company area, but if you're a Christian, I'll make sure you get to go to church. Oh, like, for real?
That would piss me off.
Oh, God, yeah. As soon as formation broke, I went straight to the training NCO. I was like, look, I need a list of every pagan soldier in this company. And her jaw dropped. She's like, oh, God, you're pagan, aren't you? I'm like, yeah, I am. And what he said just violated every policy, every regulation in the military, let alone the Constitution, and no, we ain't playing that game. So I got the list, and I actually went to those soldiers, and had one soldier that told me he talked to the chaplain and was blatantly called a Satanist by the chaplain for being Wiccan. I'm like, really? Actually, it wasn't even the chaplain I talked to, it was his little E6 chaplain assistant. And I said, well, I need to talk to him. And I still kind of shake my head at that was a very ignorant company.
Right.
Well, I was a safety NCO for that company, so I was actually friends with the battalion commander as well as the battalion XO. And after dealing with their chaplain, I was like, you know what? Screw this. This don't fly. So I did some, because you got to understand, backtracking a little bit, there is no pagan chaplain, at least in the Army. I've heard rumors about a chaplain that might be in the Air Force. I have no idea. But there's only a handful of pagan organizations that are qualified to sponsor a soldier as it used to be DFGL, a Distinguished Faith Group Leader. It's changed to DRGL, which is a Distinguished Religious Group Leader now.
Okay.
And so I found an organization. I did the paperwork. And a lot happened personally at that point in time that I won't go into. So we actually left early. But when it was all said and done, because we had to go talk to the battalion commander, because this is like October, November time frame, I wanted to have a Yule celebration on the airfield, on the base. And the chaplain was actually fighting me tooth and nail. Well, we don't endorse anybody. Like, oh, I really don't care, because we're going to talk to the colonel, because the colonel's got a lot more pull when it comes to locations. I can have a meeting on this base. And he's friends with the base commander, so I know it's going to happen.
Okay.
Well, we had a meeting between me, the colonel, the chaplain, and this little E6 chaplain assistant. And they still try to fight me, because she was, well, you can't have candles. And I said, why not? And the colonel looked straight at her and said, well, you have candles in your chapel, don't you? And, well, yeah, but they're watched. I was like, well, now, wait a minute, because any time a pagan, and I say pagan loosely,
right.
Just to clarify, to my organization, a pagan is anyone that claims Wiccan, is a witch, is a druid, is a Satru, which I understand a lot of us Satru like to claim heathen, not pagan, and that's fine. It's, to me, semantics.
Yeah, it's all semantics.
And shamans. I throw shamans. Not Native American shamans, out of respect. They prefer to be labeled or called Native American, and that's fine, too. So I explained to the colonel, because the colonel basically gave me the floor, because apparently he didn't like the discrimination that he saw going on. And he's like, well, no, what do you got to say, Sergeant Cooper? And they're like, well, it's like this. Anytime a pagan does any kind of ritual, they don't leave their candles. Because, for example, if you do a seven-knot spell, you burn your candle, you put it out. The next day you burn a little bit more, you put it out. If you're doing a ritual, you don't leave the candles. The candles burn down during your ritual. So they are never unattended. So that's a horseshit excuse.
Yeah, it's a big excuse.
He approved it. And then, you see, in the Army, they have a prayer breakfast once a month. And I was like, no, you know what? We're going to have a pagan breakfast. If they can get out of PT, which is physical training, in the morning, once a month, to go see the chaplain at a restaurant or wherever they have this prayer breakfast, we're going to do it for pagans, too. So all of a sudden, the chaplain was all excited about endorsing that at the beginning. And all of a sudden, he sees me a week later and says, well, you know what? We don't have prayer breakfast anymore, so I can't endorse it. Okay. That's fine.
So
I went to the, I was irritated, and I went to the XO, and the XO's like, oh, no. I know darn well I saw a prayer breakfast scheduled for next month. So if I find on our calendar any more mention from that chaplain of a prayer breakfast, I'm nailing him to the wall. He said, because we do have pagan understanding classes in officer training. And that was news to me, because I didn't realize at that point in time either. And, so yeah, we actually, I went to the local German restaurant on our base and talked to the owner of the restaurant, and he's like, oh, cool. He's like, because you know what? The Christians have their little prayer breakfast here every month, too. They're like, really? That's interesting news, because I was told they stopped doing that. He goes, no, there's one scheduled for a couple weeks now. I'm like, huh. Okay. So we had this, our pagan prayer breakfast, or pagan breakfast. And, yeah, the community chaplain actually showed up. Our chaplain didn't. I didn't expect him to, but I was surprised, like, three other chaplains from the community showed up from other units. And it was a very eye-opening experience from the political pagan standpoint in the military. So that was kind of my starting point in getting groups going. Now moving up in time, that was an L1. So I already knew what I had to do to start a group. Now, we went to Iraq January of 04. First thing I did, I went to the base chaplain and asked if there was anything pagan going on. He's, what's that?
I have a question, like, for you.
Yeah, go ahead.
And I'm not going to explain what the Great Rite is. If you know what it is, you know. If you don't, you don't need to know. But how do you do that in the military? How do you get away with that?
You don't.
You don't. Okay.
You don't. There are certain things you do and there are certain things you don't do.
All right. I thought so.
And, you know, I actually got asked by this chaplain in Iraq that we weren't allowed to do anything naked. They're like, well, we aren't going to, because for one, we're in a combat zone, and that's kind of a safety factor there.
Yeah.
And then I got asked if we do blood sacrifice. And like, no, we don't. You need to go back. And I know darn well, being a chaplain, you've taken pagan education. So that's just ignorance on your part. So this chaplain, we actually came, a buddy of mine, because I actually going to a new unit. It was at Fort Lewis, at 29th Signal. So I went to the chaplain, and that chaplain is actually really cool. And said, if there's anything I can do to support you, let me know. Now, I'm watching the time because I know I need to rush this, because I'm going to talk pagan for about an hour, and then we'll go into Forest Moon Paranormal, which is a part of this story.
That's fine.
For the last hour.
That's just fine. But, go ahead and talk, man. I'm just here.
Huh?
It seems I'm just here.
No, I got you. I got you. I mean, like I said in the chat room, if there's any questions, post them, but please post them in caps. Because I don't know if you're watching the chat room.
Oh, I'm
but,
always watching.
That's how we usually run our chat rooms as well. If there's questions in the chat room, then I post them in caps so I can see them.
I'm always
just
watching
realize
the chat
I'm not
room.
Paying attention.
The swamp is awesome, man. I love it.
Huh?
The swamp is, that's the name of the chat room for
right,
Black
right.
Swan. PSN has their chat room too, but it seems like during
I'm
my show they don't
PSN.
Use it. Huh?
Yeah.
So anyway, go ahead.
Anyway, yeah. So I already had in my particular unit, had the pagans identified. So we all knew each other. We got to Kuwait. This was in January of 04. And we're going to talk a little politics, too, a little bit, just briefly. Because I hate Rumsfeld. I hate Bush. They put us into a situation they weren't even ready for because they wanted money. That's really all it boils down to. That's all that war was. There was no reason for going to Iraq.
Right. No, there was no other reason for it.
Oh, my God. And I know I can talk this way because you're a paranormal as well as whatever goes.
Oh, I have
Dick Cheney.
I have a question.
Dick Cheney owns. Huh?
I have a question for you. All right.
Okay.
Amanda wants to know why you wanted to join the military in the first place. Because they don't know. And I know you told me yesterday, but go for it.
Why did I join the military in the first place? Because it won. And let me think here. I have to go back, 20-something years. I joined the military because I was a combat medic. I went in as a combat medic. And it was, to me, it's just devotion to country. Why did I reenlist and why did I go back in? It's for soldiers, because taking care of soldiers is what I do, or what I did and still do today on the pagan side of it. As far as pagan and harm none, that is a, if that was the issue, because I do get asked that a lot, is I don't follow the Wiccan read because I am a witch. I'm not Wiccan.
Me too.
And I know
I'm
a lot,
not Wiccan
I know
either.
A lot of,
I'm not Wiccan either.
No. I was a combat medic. I loved being a combat medic. I would never change a thing. I'm disabled for PTSD because of Somalia. Because Somalia was a bloodbath. We wouldn't even discuss that situation because that's where my PTSD stems from, and I don't like reliving it, even though
that's
I do it.
That's just fine. You don't have to.
No. But now, getting back to Iraq, Dick Cheney owned Halliburton. If I went to the dining facility in Iraq, Halliburton ran the dining facility. So if I walked in and got an apple and a Coke, they made $13. If I went in and got a full meal, they made $13. If I saw in and got a bottle of water, they made $13. That's Halliburton, and that's Dick Cheney. So we get to Iraq, and our first thing they tell us is the insurgents are running piano wire across the highways. So we need to counter that. So we took steel T-poles, posts, and welded them to our brush guards of our Humvees, so we cut the piano wire before it got to our gunners' heads. That was our first interaction with Iraq, Iraq. Our training in Kuwait consisted of, basically, we were taught how to do drive-by shootings. We were taught how to shoot from moving vehicles, how to shoot while we were walking without stopping, and a whole lot of other stuff. Which, yeah. We had no armor. That's what I wanted to get at, too.
Yeah, I remember that.
The situation. Our trucks, our armor was plywood and rubber mats. That was our armor. Some reservists brought that up to Rumsfeld when he visited them in Kuwait, I guess a year later. And he was told, or this reservist unit was told, well, you just got to deal with what you're given. Really? You put us into that damn situation, and we just got to deal with what we're given. And that's why we have a 6,000 soldier death in Iraq. Yeah. Because we got to deal with what we're given. And now we have 22 soldiers that kill themselves every day. And that's just veterans. That doesn't count the other two or three active duty that kill themselves every day out of suicide. Those are the numbers right now, currently.
Yeah, and people don't seem to understand the reason why people are killing themselves coming out of the military. Well, you could explain that much better than I do, but I do have a clue, and
well,
I am sympathetic.
And here's the thing. A lot of soldiers and a lot of veterans will not get PTSD on their records. They won't get that because, one, there's a stigma with a lot of people that you're just crazy. And I take medication. I live in the mountains. I live on a farm. I have a 4- and 5-year-old to keep me stable and a wife that takes care of me.
Awesome.
And I have, I run Forest Moon Paranormal. I work with Search and Rescue on a 4x4 team, which actually we're on standby right now. But we haven't been called, so I'm not worried about it. I keep busy. I don't watch news. We don't even have, we have a TV, but we use Netflix and things like that for the kids because I don't watch TV. And I get enough news off Facebook that it's enough to drive you nuts.
Right.
But I don't. It took me 2 years. I bought Black Hawk Down, but it took me 2 years to watch it, and I cried all the way through it. So no, I don't watch. I don't
right.
watch war movies. I don't watch TV because politics really pisses me off.
So
I look at this. Look at the state of this country right now, and it disgusts me.
Well, yeah, the state of this country disgusts me, too. And the fact that you might have heard it. I don't know. I think this whole thing with
Hillary.
Yeah, and Trump, you know, Trump's going to be shot, and Hillary is just...
I'm voting Jill Stein. That's who I'm voting for. I'm voting third party so that the establishment does not get my vote. And the more people vote outside the establishment, the more the establishment's going to maybe wake up, probably not, but maybe wake up and say, oh, I guess everyone's mad. You think? I despise Trump. I was going to vote Bernie. But no, the DNC made sure Bernie didn't, you know, stay in. So,
right. But yeah. To me, Bernie's a hypocrite too. And I was going to vote city and state, but when it came to the president, I wasn't going to cast my vote. That's the way I was going to handle that.
Right. And I can see that. And I don't know. I'm staying here and I'm fighting. Regardless of how it goes down, I'll stay here and I'll fight. This is my country. They're not going to run me out, regardless of who wins the office.
And that's the way I feel about it, too. Come and take my guns. Come and take my gun. Go ahead. I dare you.
They won't. They can't. They can't because they don't have the manpower. I get into the discussion of, I get pictures and reports from a lot of different people, especially the last 3 weeks or so, of where you see UN vehicles. And a couple of the pictures, one, he had a video, and his point was there's no bumper numbers on the military trucks. Like, well, for one, the guy's wearing ACUs, but it's a military convoy. No bumper numbers, maybe because a lot of times when you deploy and take your equipment, you leave your equipment in place for the next unit to come in. When you come back to the stateside, you draw new equipment, and you don't always have time to put bumper numbers right on, or they just pick the stuff up from the port. But based on the fact that he's wearing military gear, has ACUs on, that's a military convoy. It's all military vehicles. I got shown another picture of, it was a UN convoy, but it was taken right from the movie. It's like, really? Come on, get me something real.
Yeah, the misinformation on Facebook is disgusting.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, they make the UN vehicles in Michigan. So, yeah, sure, you're going to see a UN convoy driving out of Michigan to the port to, you know, ship them off to Indonesia or something. Or wherever they, where the UN. UN is so weak, we've had to bail them out of every mission they've been on. So am I worried about the UN? Hell no.
No.
We had to bail them out of Kuwait. We had to bail them out of Somalia. We had to bail them out of Iraq. We had to bail them out of Kosovo. I was on standby to go to Kosovo. That would have been my fifth combat tour. But I had a cool E-7 that was like, hey, Specialist Cooper, you want to go to Kosovo? He's like, not really. He goes, okay. Hogarth, pack your stuff because Coop's already been in combat twice. You ain't been, so you're going into place. I'm like, thank you. But I was on a push team that got the equipment ready to go, and then they sent the Apache still. I was in an Apache unit at that point. I've been in infantry units, cavalry units, Apache units, an Apache unit, ambulance company, 3rd Army, and a signal unit was my last one.
Right.
So I've got a well-rounded view of different units of the military.
Right, and I thought we were going to talk about the pagan aspect of the military, and it seems we got misdirected.
I get sidetracked easily.
Yeah,
anyway,
I understand that.
So we got to skip in Kuwait. Okay, you know about the convoy. We had no armored. We did a protective ritual over the convoy, and it was kind of cool because we actually had soldiers that were looking, going, "What are you guys doing? We're doing a protective ritual of the convoy." Like, oh, cool. And they left. They left this room. But I was woken up the very next morning after that, and someone said, "Sergeant Cooper, you gotta see this." And I stepped out, and there were like thousands, I mean thousands, of dragonflies all flying in unison, all towards Iraq. Like, huh, I'll take that as a sign.
I would too, no doubt.
We had no incident, none, zero. In our 3-day convoy from Doha, Kuwait to Balad, Iraq, nothing happened, nothing broke down, no shots were fired, nothing. Now when we got to Balad, that whole year in Balad, we got mortared every day. We never lost anybody in our whole unit. At one point, getting back to the beginning, so we got to Iraq, and the first night, one of my pagan buddies and I were sitting outside smoking cigarettes. We were looking at the full moon. Like, so you know what? If there's nothing pagan going on this base, I think Desert Moon Grove is fitting. because I mean you can't turn you cannot dispute the beauty of a full moon in a desert. You really can't.
So that's where you got the name.
That's where we got the name, Desert Moon Grove.
That's awesome.
And we went to the base chaplain, and of course he gave us his 2 cents, but he's like, well, you got to get the paperwork. I'm like, okay, no problem. I got a hold of one of our organizations that sponsor soldiers and got the paperwork started. And, of course, the chaplain wasn't too pleased because he thought it'd stop us. Now, originally, when I started Desert Moon, it was going to be a once-a-week meeting. Let's see, Maureen, the protocol is necessary. You have to be 501c3, and you have to have, we'll get there because that's part of the story anyway. And let's see, I got 25 minutes, I see. But we'll go over a little bit, and the paranormal side is a little, won't take too much to talk about, that's fine. But, so we got the paperwork started, we were going to do it once a week, and the chaplain gave us a spot in his little chapel compound, which the very next day was the spot he gave us was nothing but lumber. He piled lumber up in our spot that he gave us. So nice of him.
Yeah.
But he was a major. So he pretty up there on the food chain. So I talked to my E7, he's like, and he used to work for IG, so he knew the regulations. He's like, yeah, just meet your shop. I'm like, okay. Well, we had our first meeting, and about 30 soldiers showed up.
Wow.
And they came back the next night, and the next night. So we just started having them every night. And I mean, we had soldiers that came in that lost their buddies in convoys or, kicking doors in or whatever.
Yeah.
We did healing rituals for them. I have a picture on Forest Moon Paranormal and Forest Moon Grove, because Forest Moon Grove is our pagan group. That's our headquarters. Forest Moon Paranormal is our paranormal branch off, which we'll get to that. But Forest Moon Grove, I have a whole library of military regulations. I have pictures of our Beltane rituals we did, of Lamas, of Mabon. We honored every Sabbath. And we had Druids, we had Asatru, we had a Shinto. We even had a Buddhist soldier come in because he didn't fit into any of the categories. And over that year, we had at least easily 100 soldiers over that year. In blood. And same thing in Telfar, because we went back to Fort Lewis in January of 05 and went back to Telfar, Iraq, November 05 to October 06. Now, I wrote, and it sounds all peachy, but I wrote articles of discrimination for Moonshadow magazine while we were in Telfar, because I never saw near as much discrimination as I did in Telfar. In Telfar, we were given a tent to meet in. I went home in R&R for my 2 weeks. I came back, our tent was gone. And never mind, they can have Bible studies in buildings on the same company compound. But we're pagan, so they took our tent away. So we started meeting in my CHU, which is a housing unit. It's a two-man trailer, basically. And again, like I said, in that year, we had another 100 soldiers that showed up. I had some that they were gone for a week at a time. They come in for one day, and they came straight to my CHU. And we had 30 soldiers every night. And the first sergeant pulled me aside and said, you can't be doing that. I'm like, well, get me a spot for us to meet. He's like, well, I can't do that. I'm like, well, then we're going to meet in my CHU, so I'm not turning away pagan troops that need help. Well, I'm going to UCMJ you, and that's where they take your rank and they can take your pay and whatnot. They're like, you know what? Do what you got to do because it won't last too long. Because if you want to keep your first sergeant stripes, you should know your regulations. It got so bad within my battalion that my own chaplain threatened the battalion with an IG complaint in our name. Okay. And if they want to go read my articles that I wrote for Moonshadow Magazine, I wrote once a month for Moonshadow, and it that's a magazine that basically went out of business. But I still have the articles, and today in 2010, I was actually screwed out of retirement by 6 months. I did 19 years, 6 months in the Army. 6 months shy of my 20. I'm medically retired. I'm not 20 retired because they med boarded me instead of letting me retire.
So in other words, they didn't have to pay the full pension.
Exactly.
Do you think they did that partly because you are were doing so much active stuff and with paganism?
I don't think so. I really don't. Cause it was a different set of people. Okay. It was all politics on that one. Right. Because, again, another major. Well, getting back to Blood real quick, I think it was kind of cool because this major, towards the end of our tour in Blood, this chaplain who's about to retire, he's like, "Hey, I want you to write me an AAR." I'm like, "Okay." Now, an AAR is an after-action review. Basically, he wanted me to write make a booklet of what the next leaders need to do to keep our group going. And basically make him look good. Basically, he wanted me to... what did he do for us, and how did you know, and how can we improve? Okay, fine. I made an AAR, and I give it. He was gone by the time I took this book to a colonel. Now this is a full bird colonel chaplain who took his place, and I gave him the AAR, and I left. And he saw me one day. He's like, "I've been looking for you." He's like, "And I don't like your AAR." I was like, "What do you mean, sir?" Well, you gotta be, you're joking, right? Everything you put for improvements, like you should have been at the chaplain's meetings to hear what was going on. Your group should have been listed on the religious services. He's like, "All that should have been done automatically. You're telling me that major didn't do any of this?" Like, "Sir, this major didn't do anything to try to proselytize to me. That's what this chaplain did. This chaplain did nothing to help my group. Because my group met in my maintenance shop because we weren't giving a spot to meet." He was to say he was pissed is an understatement.
But, yeah, it sounds like it.
That's some, you know, you've got good chaplains, you've got bad chaplains. I would say today about 90% of them are all for themselves and all for winning souls for Christ. That's why today Forest Moon Grove is a very slow-moving dormant group, because I can't find pagan troops anymore because they've gone back into hiding.
Well, I can understand why they do that, too.
Well, they have to. They have to keep their rank. They have to keep progressing in the military if they want to stay in the military. Because in 2007 is when the Evangelical Association flooded the chaplaincy corps with their little minions. And the chaplain's job, regardless of what their faith is to make sure all soldiers, regardless of faith, are taken care of. That Correct. Is the chaplain's job. Today, the chaplain's job to them is to win souls for Christ, regardless of whose toes they step on. In 2009, in Afghanistan, there was a colonel that had Bibles made through the Evangelical Association that was printed in Pushtun, whatever I think that's what the language is called. And he had an infantry unit escort him, which is a violation of regulation. He had an infantry unit disperse these Bibles into the Afghanistani village. He was found out. He was slapped on the wrist and ridiculed, but it was exposed. Did it change anything? Not really. In about 2009, 2010, they came up with a religious, a spiritual fitness test. Basically, if you are atheist, and I think they probably threw that pagan bracket into the ballpark too, you could be removed from service because you're a liability for depression.
Really? How the hell are you a liability for depression just because you're atheist or pagan?
Because you don't believe in their God.
So what the hell does that?
That only lasted about a year.
I don't see their God doing anything.
Huh?
I don't see their God doing anything to stop all the crap. It's all fed about money. It's all about the money.
If you want to hear what's really going on in the military, check out the MRFF. That's www.mrff.org. That's the Military Religious Freedom Foundation. It's run by Mikey Weinstein, who is a Jew. He's Jewish. But he is going after and about 80% of his clientele are Christian that are bringing up points that the military is doing to discriminate against other religions.
This is the first I've heard about it. I've not talked with anybody who has come out of the service that was pagan until I got to meet you. And I believe you. I believe every word that's coming out of your mouth, and it's disheartening. It's pissing me off. It sounds exactly like what the government would do, and how to keep the power into their control, being the Christian sect, and because you can't be a pagan and be president. You know, I mean, they won't allow that shit.
Well, okay, here's the thing. Our founding fathers, and I've gotten into this fight with so many people, our country was not founded on Christian principles, because George Washington, and we'll get to the show, but if you listen to S4, 2 weeks ago, we talked about the Illuminati. The Illuminati was started by the Masons.
Yes, it was.
If you look at our founding fathers, they were all Masons, and they were all of pagan belief.
But they hid behind Christianity.
They hid behind Christianity because look at the covens back in the 1800s. They had to hide.
Yeah.
It's the same thing. They were all pagan, and they had to throw in Bible verses, and they had to throw in Christianity in there to cover up. But in all reality, they were all pagan. Look at the shape of the Pentagon. Look at the, if you're, I've got a video of the history of the Masons, and oh my God. No.
Right.
Yeah. It's astounding. And don't get me wrong, I do like Christians. I have Christian friends. Not a big deal. But yeah, the ones that proselytize, the ones that try to save my soul, no.
No, I don't have any tolerance for people that try to push themselves, their beliefs, and so on me. I personally, the way I look at it, I'm pagan, and I'm pagan, like I told you yesterday, I am pagan because I want you to know what page I'm on, basically. Mm-hmm. I believe all religion, I don't care what religion it is, I believe all religion is bullshit. I practice the occult, magic. Mm-hmm. I am a Reiki master, but Reiki is not my religion.
No, Reiki's
I don't
a
have
practice.
A religion. So, huh?
Yeah, Reiki's a practice.
Reiki is a practice.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, just like yoga is a practice. Some people say it's mm-hmm. religious, but yoga on the side of the pond, anyway, is a practice.
Exactly. Now, on some cool notes, because I don't like being all negative, on some cool points, though, we had an outstanding group in Iraq. And my deity that I work with, I don't like the word worship, because deities, to me, and that's where the dogma comes in. Even with pagans, they have to worship their deity. They have to do everything just a certain way. And
Right. The goddess is my friend. She's not
exactly.
Somebody I worship.
Exactly. Now, my friend is Morrigan. Very fitting for a soldier. Very fitting for anyone that... Morrigan, for those that don't know, is the Celtic goddess of war, death, rebirth. And she took care of everything we needed. I mean, right down to coffee. As funny as that sounds, right down to coffee. I'd say, I love Morrigan. This is my last pot of coffee. So, I mean, our big thing, we drank coffee every night. That was our meeting. If we needed to do a ritual for somebody, we did. If we prepared for the Sabbaths, we did studies, we taught new people. And I got accused of proselytizing in Telefar because I had a Desert Moon Grove flyer up in the DFAT, basically for the pagan soldiers to find where our meeting spot was.
Okay.
And I got accused of proselytizing. I'm like, are you serious? That's for pagan troops. It's not for anyone who's not pagan. So that shut him up. But I was like, look, we need coffee bad. And sure enough, here comes coffee in the mail that day. But,
That's
you
cool.
Knew when we needed it. Now, talk about Forest Moon Grove. Forest Moon Grove, I actually started it in Iraq towards the end of our tour. Because I sent the message out on Witch Fox when I first got there that we were troops in Iraq and we needed supplies. And there was such a tremendous amount of support. I mean, we're talking everyone from DJ Conway to Avron Zell to Isaac Bonowitz when he was alive. Care Cooling, Celia, Blackboard Knight, the song group, they sent packages. We had Serpent's Kiss out of California. We had The Wiccan Way, another store. We had pagan support like there's no tomorrow. So when it came to supplies, we were taken care of. So to keep that going, I started Forest Moon Grove up for civilians that wanted to support troops in the military that were deployed, that were pagan. And today it's up to 2,500 people. We don't have any troops to support, but when I got out of the army is when I started the homeless closet and I started doing more pagan community support services.
Well, it sounds like you're doing a good job and that you're helping people. You're the first group I've seen on Facebook that actually is worth something, if I might say so.
We'll talk about the paranormal side because we do more paranormal than we do pagan services anymore.
Okay.
Unless we find pagans that need and in fact, we had a passing over situation here about a week ago that I had to find somebody to go down to Seattle and take care of. We do that. We network with a lot of different people to get things done.
Yeah.
And for any listeners that are in Washington State, we will be at Pagan Pride in Tacoma, October 1st and 2nd. Look for the Forest Moon Paranormal booth, and I'll be teaching a workshop, and I'll be on their paranormal panel. And that's at Freehouse Square.
And I might add that Black Swamp Radio is on Witchbox, so you can get us there.
Outstanding.
Too. Well, yeah. Why would I have a station and not have it on Witchbox, you know?
Yeah, why not?
Yeah.
Forest Moon Grove. I don't think I have Forest Moon Paranormal listed on Witch Fox, but Forest Moon Grove is also in the Washington State list. Thinking here. Yeah, so I started Forest Moon Grove up, and when I got out of the Army is when I kept on. We actually sponsored and supported 16 different pagan groups that were in Iraq, Afghanistan, Korea, and got them the support and supplies they needed. We can also offer DRGL status for those that need it. So if you know any pagan troops that need help, by all means, contact us. Look for Forest Moon Grove or Forest Moon Paranormal on Facebook. We don't have a website. We just use Facebook. That's where most people are anyway, and it saves cost.
Yeah.
So I started Forest Moon Grove up. Now, when we were in Telefar is where we actually saw more paranormal activity. That was where my third UFO sighting was. Getting to the paranormal side now. Pagans deal with paranormal activity on a routine basis, and we see it as normal. Because, I mean, come on, we deal with elementals, we deal with fairies, we deal with what civilians, non-pagans, there we go, see as paranormal, we see it as normal activity.
There's something that we need to clarify right there, right from the get-go. is exactly that. And the fact that we see Bigfoot as just another brother. We don't have a problem believing in Bigfoot. We believe we know there's fairies out there. We don't believe in fairies. We know the fairies are out there. We know the god and the goddess is out there. We know ET is out there. Whether we've been abducted or not, it doesn't matter. We know. It's just something. It's like people ask me, I live in a haunted house. You know, I really do live in a haunted house. I have absolutely no problem. And I'm blowing up my mic, sorry. I have absolutely no problem at all living in this house with spirit or spirits or whatever. It doesn't bother me in the least. We come to an understanding when I first moved in here. I mean, and the guys that live here that are on the other side aren't bad. They're not bad people. They get a little upset if I change some shit, but they're not upset. Not bad. So anyhow,
don't ever remodel your closet. That's just a no-no.
My closet.
Yeah, you don't touch closets.
Really?
Yep. Don't ever touch the closet.
I've never heard that before. Why?
That's kind of like I guess I don't like using the word portal, but that's kind of like their sacred space.
for a lot of
spirits.
I got you. Yeah.
I don't know why. It's just that's just one of those things you don't mess with.
You don't go. You don't go in the
club. I have some really cool pictures from our llamas ritual we did in Talifar, because I have a picture, and I took a picture of all four quarters, and the elements actually showed themselves.
Oh,
literally.
Cool.
It wasn't a camera glitch. I know that for a fact. But there's actually a streak, and they do somersaults as they leave on all four quarters.
That's awesome.
It was very cool.
I caught the fire elemental in my fire pit while fire was going, and I never showed anybody except for the wife, and I don't know what happened to the picture, but.
Mm-hmm. Well, those pictures I can see on, and I'll send them to you later if you want to post them. But they're posted in Forest Boone Grove and Paranormal.
Cool.
And then we learned about gin.
Oh, who's the gin? For these people here that don't understand who the gin are?
Hard to explain. They are a negative entity. I don't use the term demon, because demon connotates it's a religious thing, and to me it's not.
Well, demons can make, jinn can make demons look like pussies.
Yeah, they're like a demon 100 times on steroids. And it does not take a Muslim to remove them.
No.
You can get a shaman to do that. Because some people, me included, always thought it should be a Muslim to remove a jinn. Just because it's their culture, just like a lot of if we have a case on Native American land, I would usually get the local medicine man to take care of that case, because that's their realm.
Right.
And also more in respect of the spirit, the native spirit.
So anyhow,
to get one of their own. So Forest Boone Grove was going strong. I've always been getting to the paranormal. My first paranormal experience, I was about, I get mixed up. I was either 12 or 14. And I was by myself. We had a 40-acre farm in Big Lake. And for those who don't know, we are headquartered in Concrete, Washington State, up in the mountains, away from people. I don't deal with people unless I need to or want to. We do go to our town sporadically, because my parents are in, you know, about 30 miles away. But my neighbor called and said the cows were out. I was 14. I just had a knee injury, so I was in a knee brace. And the neighbors called and said the cows were out, and I needed to go down and get them because the gates of the highway was open, and they could get on the highway. So I walked down there, and I grew up around cows. We had 10 or 12 Hereford, and to me, they're big dogs. But I walked down there, and my cow always followed me around like a big dog. She was kind of like my guardian, and she never got out. And sure enough, she was still in our pasture. And sure enough, all the cows were out. Now, bear in mind, the grass wasn't tall. I could see everything clearly. And I went out in the pasture, and the cows looked at me, and they looked at the open gate, which was about a quarter mile away. And they ran for the gate. And I don't know what it was. Still don't know what it was to this day. But something terrified them to where they actually locked up their hooves and get it to a stop. They all looked at something I couldn't see. Not a skunk, not an animal. And they ran terrified with their tails in the air about half a mile back to our barn. Didn't even slow down for the fence. They just ran right back through the fence.
Really?
I just kind of looked at it, because prior to that, I wasn't into the paranormal at all. Ghost spirits, whatever. I might see a UFO 1950s documentary. I was born in 69, but even as a kid, I might have seen one of those 1970s black and white UFO documentaries and went, oh, that's kind of cool, whatever. So that was my first paranormal experience, and even back then I was like, kind of cool. Went back to the house, didn't think nothing of it, and started my pagan studies about 1990 when I joined the Army. I was born and raised Assembly of God, went to Christian school, went to church Wednesday night and Sunday morning and night, and Christian school my entire life, and Jimmy Swaggart Bible College for a semester, and then I joined the Army. Never fit in. Even my mom could tell you, she was praying heaven down that I'd be, stay Christian, but she knew I didn't fit. I had to come home from church, put my play clothes on, and be out in the woods grounding. That was my life. And so I started picking up all the occult books I could find, from tarot to astrology to magic in general, and started reading. Had a ghost in Germany in my room, named him Fritz. He was a German German soldier. Of course, we were in German barracks. And I remember one day, one of my cook buddies was sitting on my bed, and we were getting ready to go out and go clubbing. And I was telling him about Fritz. He's like, man, I don't believe in no damn ghost. And the bed collapsed. Well, never had a problem with that bed ever. I'm like, he just pissed off Fritz. Like, man, there ain't no ghost. We fixed the bed. He sat down, and we're talking. He goes, so you have a ghost, huh? And it collapsed again. We fixed it. Never had a problem with it ever, even after that, it kind of woke him up a little bit. But, and then there was another night, and I told you about this the other day. A buddy of mine were walking in down an alley. And it was weird. It was about 10 and 11 o'clock at night. That's when you go clubbing in Germany. That's when all the activity is. And both our vision went black and white. And we're walking down this alley, and of course...
So did you step into
the... We both saw it, but we didn't see nothing about it until about 10 minutes later.
Did you step into the moment?
No. In Germany, they have what's called the Rotskeller, and that's kind of like the Chamber of Commerce or the community center here in the States. But the Rotskeller was a restaurant in current time. And as we're walking towards it, our vision changes to black and white, and we both saw a 1920s, 1930s era limousine with a Hitler flag or a Nazi flag on one side and a German flag on the other. And we saw Hitler and his entourage come out of the Rotskeller. Now, they all looked at us, but I don't know what they saw. I don't know if they saw just Germans walking through an alley or what they saw. Looking back, I find it weird they even saw us at all, because it was like we walked into a time warp or a rift in time or what. But we walked out the alley, took a left up the street, and about 10 minutes later, I was like, did you see something weird? And he went off, because we both described the exact same scene, the other scene. So that woke me up to the paranormal.
Yes, that's weird. I don't know what you did.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what you did.
I don't either. That was the only time it ever happened. So in 94, I got out of the Army. That was after Somalia. And I had a friend. And we woke up one morning, and she's like, I don't know what happened last night, but I've got a triangular puncture mark on my lower abdomen. And it's like, huh. And she had some other bruising and whatnot. And it's funny.
Did they take her?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, God, I'm getting there. I had no idea what alien abduction was at this point in time. Because I had no UFO sightings, nothing at this point in time. And we turn on the TV, and I don't believe in irony, but there was a, kind of like Maury, or not even Maury, I can't remember what the show was back then, but they had a panel of alien abductees on their show. And they started describing how it started when they woke up with a triangular puncture mark on their lower abdomen. And then it went into the whole hybrid program, of having a fetus and having it removed 2 to 3 weeks later. Well, she had the fetus, and we went to Madigan Army Hospital, because that's all I knew, because I just gotten out of the Army. And sure enough, they did the ultrasound, and there was no fetus. And they were baffled, because they were like, you have all signs that you were pregnant. There's no miscarriage. There's no signs of tissue. There's no signs of miscarriage. There's just no fetus. And, like, damn. Well, my first book I picked up was by Dr. David Jacobs, and that was Secret Life of, I can't remember the full title, but it's Secret Life. And I read that from cover to cover, and I was pissed. I was like, oh, hell no. Ain't no alien messing with my life. Well, I started researching, and that's where my UFO and alien abduction research started. From that point in time, I was started working with abductees, because having that experience of knowing one personally, yeah. So I started working with abductees, and I was listening to a show that you had on, I think it was today or yesterday, and it might have been Deborah's show, I'm not sure where the... No, it wasn't Deborah, but it was a woman that was talking about how she meets people that don't know they've been abducted.
Oh, Linda's. Yeah, that was today. Linda Salva. I had Linda Salva.
Yeah, I heard that show. I can completely relate, because you don't know how many clients I've had that start describing what's going on, and I hate being the one to tell them. I really do. Now, let's get to Forest Moon Paranormal now.
Okay.
We're not a scientific group. We are a crisis management group. That's exactly what we call ourselves, and that's exactly how we handle things. It really irritates me how many times we've had to go in after other paranormal groups to clean up their mess.
Oh, man, that pisses me off when I have to do that, too.
Paranormal TV did not help us.
No.
It did, but it did not. But now you've got every Tom, Dick, and Harry that sees Paranormal TV and goes, I want to be a Ghostbuster.
Oh, and what gets to
sure
me...
Enough, sure enough...
Go ahead.
They look on Craigslist, and they find somebody that's teaching ghostbusting skills. Well, what they don't teach them is, one, how to pass over spirits, protection, and you don't know how many clients I've had that are in tears because they don't know where to turn, because they think they're crazy now, because this paranormal group came in and took a picture of this wonderful apparition, or what they think is an apparition, or this awesome EVP, and yep, you're haunted, bye. Now they've pissed off the spirit, and this client gets to deal with it.
Yeah, Yeah. What gets to me is that the one parent on a travel channel, there's that one guy that does the paranormal activity crap, and he's constantly going, "Oh, you can enter into my body and speak through me if you want to." And it's like, what? You got to be really stupid. I mean, why would you take something else into you like that? You're freaking high.
Well, it's all drama and it's reality TV. It's all it is. But you know damn well ain't no spirit went into them.
Yeah, I know that, and you know that, that it's all. But you get these people that don't know Jack, and they watch right. this, and then they do it. Well, I've seen it on TV, so that's the way that you do it. And it's like, what the hell are you supposed to do about that? I mean, how do you argue with someone who, you know, well, you don't know anything because this is what this guy did on TV, and because he's on TV, he knows more than you do. And it's like, what the hell's wrong with you?
No. Now, and also, let me clarify, for anyone that does want to get into paranormal investigation, that's fine. But what you do is you find yourself a reputable group that's been around for at least 5 to 10 years. And I don't even like the number 5. But 5 to 10 years at least, hopefully, they're reputable. Look at their history. Have they helped clients or have they harmed clients? And then ask them to mentor you for at least a year. At least. That's how you learn. You don't go to a damn school and pay $200 for them to teach you ghost busting skills. No, I've heard this. Anyway, moving along.
Yeah, go ahead. Move along.
Yeah. I started Four Spoon Paranormal up in 2006, formally. But I've been in the abduction and UFO field for over 20 years. But we handle all aspects. Bigfoot, cryptozoology in general, which is Mothman, Chupacabra, Swampman, Dogman, you name it.
Skinwalkers.
I have a guy here locally that actually goes out and intermingles with Bigfoot up in our mountains. He'll be speaking at the Paracon. Paracon, we are having up here for free. It's October 22nd. It'll be from 8 a.m. to midnight. Because we're actually, we're covering every topic. I wasn't going to be a speaker, but I am doing a lecture on ufology and the history and the present and abduction.
Awesome.
We have Derek Tyler, who many of you listeners I know are familiar with. He's been abducted. He's an abductee, and he's also going into my labs, which is military abductions. We have Derek Tyler, who is our Bigfoot specialist. I don't like using the word expert, so I don't believe he's an expert.
Okay, here's a question for you.
Okay.
What is the difference? How can you tell the difference between being abducted by ET and military?
Personally, none of my abductees that I've worked with fit the profile, and I don't even know exactly what the profile of a my lab abduction is. I know some get pulled down versus going up, which I think the my labs go down versus going up or out. As far as the signs and symptoms, I believe they're the same.
Okay. All right.
Do you have the answer to that?
I don't have the answer to it because I'm not. I've never been abducted by military. It's been ET
right.
that's taken me, and
okay.
I'm going to say ET because everybody understands that generalization, and just leave it at that.
Right. Now, I've had two encounters with reptilians. One was in Atlanta, Georgia.
Oh, shit.
And the other was in Fort Lewis. Both times I was in the Army. And if you're not familiar with reptilians, they usually you won't see them physically. You'll feel them. And it was more of a psychic attack because I came out of my apartment in Atlanta and noticed right away there was praying mantises all around me. regular praying mantises. I've never seen one before. That was the first and only time I've ever seen one. And all of a sudden, there was a presence that I've never felt before at that point in time. And I got instantly nauseous and had a splitting headache. And that lasted for about 10 minutes. All of a sudden, there was a shrill, it was almost like a dog whistle, but that you can't hear. It was like a shrill electronic piercing, and I was instantly better, and the praying mantises were gone. Now, I've been told that the grays watch out for me, not saying I'm anything but human, I'm just a witch, but I've That's been told nice by mediums and other witches that the grays do watch out for me, or something watches out for me.
That's a nice way to cover it.
Huh?
That's a nice way to cover it.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't think the grays are watching out for me, because I don't like the grays either.
I never did like the grays.
But here's the thing. The grays and the reptilians, or a certain select species of the grays, are at war with the reptilians. So in that regard, it makes sense. But I encountered the reptilians again in Fort Lewis, and again, if the reptilians have a smell. They have a smell of sewer, rotten flesh, and that's the only way I can describe it. And they try to strike you with fear or dread.
Really?
They cloak themselves, so you won't see them. You'll feel them. But if you have a dreaded feeling, then it's usually probably reptilian.
That goes with what Linda told me. I thought it was the two guys that died here. And she told me, no, that one of them was the guy that lived here, and one of them was something else that was darker. And he was the one I was smelling. And I assumed it smelled like the smell of death. Mm-hmm. And... so I went through that, and that's been taken care of. That entity doesn't come around the house anymore.
Now, they're a very weak species. They do bleed. You can shoot them if they actually show up physically. But they're highly advanced technologically. And they're very psychic. They're up here where I live. They actually have a nest up in another mountain that's not far from us, but we have an agreement. They don't mess with me, I don't mess with them, whatever. Someone right. comes up missing, that's another story. But and I don't know where our paths crossed in maybe a past life, or I have no idea how they know me, but I do know they know. And like I said, I'm human. I'm not anything special. I know that, and I will never never say anything else. But, okay, so Forest Moon Paranormal, we cover all aspects. We also have an astral team, which, in that sense, having an astral team makes distance of a case no issue. And the presence or the observance of what's going on in a client's home is much easier for them to see.
Now, for the listeners, explain what the astral team does, how it does it, and...
basically, when I get a client, Danny, I'll get to that. Your first UFO encounter, okay. And ghostly encounter, okay. Anyway, so an astral team, if you're familiar with the CIA remote viewing program, that's a program the CIA came up with in the early 60s for Vietnam. It was a psychic warfare program, where they used people, but these people had to have, they were psychic, and they had to have a programmer with them. And they basically used these random, well, they weren't random, but I'm not really sure how they worked, but they were grid coordinates. And they would view. That's the word remote viewing. It's kind of like that, but these grid coordinates, I believe, came from the astral plane. Okay. So what my team does is all they need is a picture or just to talk to the client, and they can get an energy lock on them. We've actually covered some, we've had cases in Europe where they can astral there. It takes a much stronger, one of our guys that, or individual that's been doing it for a lot longer, who knows what they're doing more. We also have a school where we teach astral, but usually it has to be someone that's already astral before, and then we teach them self-defense, we teach them remote or astral warfare, if that's the word, basically how to fight entities in the astral. So basically they can get an energy lock on the client and they can go to their home. And they can see basically in their home what's causing the problem and remove it. Now,
well,
we also...
Well, I wanted to add okay. to that, that your energy, everyone's energy, it's like your fingerprint. So your energy is, if you're sensitive enough, I can tell the difference between Bear and Amanda and Marine and or whoever else is in this chat room. Yeah, because it's that specific most of the time.
Yeah, it is. Exactly. Thank you for putting that in. but yeah, that's the astral team. And on that note, we don't always have to fight spirits. I do want to clarify that. We are also about, I have several psychics and mediums in the group as well that help spirits pass on. We're not here just for the client, we're here for the spirit as well. Spirits are people that have passed on, generally speaking. That's what a spirit is. So you've got to respect them. If I actually have a physical case, which I actually don't go on physical locations too often because we don't get called in locally too often, and again, I blame paranormal groups, paranormal TV for that, because a lot of people don't like paranormal groups coming in. Let's see, where was I going with this? But yeah, so we help spirits pass on. If you want to see a good example, watch The Others. That's the best movie I think out there that shows you from a spirit's perspective.
Oh.
You are the one. You are the one that's intruding on their space.
That movie, if you haven't seen The Others, you need to, but beware right now. That movie is slow, and you can fall asleep through it. But at the last half hour is awesome for
shocking.
What he's explaining.
It's shocking.
Yeah.
Because if you have no idea what's going on,
and then all
the
of a sudden,
end of
boom.
It will blow your mind.
Oh, yeah. I don't want to give I don't want to give any spoiler out, man. But you know the whole thing. If I see dead people, it's a whole brand new meaning.
Exactly, and I think that is right on. That's exactly how spirits feel. They're
yeah.
not intruding on your home; you're intruding on theirs.
And that's why they get pissed when you move something, when you change
yep.
something, when you move into a house where people have died, and. You decide that you're going to tear this wall out or you're going to do this. They don't like that.
No. Not at all. Now, and that's also where we come into mediation. We've actually had cases where we simply had to mediate. The client wants to know who it is, and that's the case a lot of times. Unless it's a darker entity, then we have to remove it. But... yeah, a lot of times you just simply, they don't know they're scaring your dog or your kids. And you just explain, look, you're scaring my dog and kids, and we'd really just like that to stop. And they're like, oh, well, damn, I never thought about that. So then you have, you just mediate. And so you have clients that are okay with the spirit staying. You just want them to understand they're scaring the dog and kids, you know. And case closed. And we do a follow-up. 2 weeks to a month later, or if they have issues, and you know, by all means, contact us. But yeah, we're here for the spirit as well as the client. Okay, so I was asked about my first UFO sighting. My first UFO sighting was in Germany. I had two sightings in Germany, one in Iraq. I'm watching the time here. But I had to take a soldier to prison, to Mannheim. And we were coming back from Mannheim. It was about midnight. And we were going back to Illesheim, which is where I was based out of. But we were actually going past Kitzingen again. And I looked to the left. Something caught my eye. And there was a giant orange, looked like a basketball, but it was as big as the full moon, which was on my right. And it was just hovering there. And I pointed it out to my driver, and he's like, huh, that's odd. Because, I mean, the full moon was on the right of the Audubon. And this giant orb, which was as big as the full moon, was on our left. And we watched it for about 10 minutes. And just like you would flip a light switch, it was gone. Just that fast. And I'm reading another question.
Yeah.
So that was my first UFO sighting. I'd already experienced the abduction side, so I wasn't, you know, it didn't shock me. It wasn't a shock and awe thing or nothing. I was like, oh, cool, I've had my first UFO sighting. Because, you know, the abduction side was first. And it really irritates me, too, because I had two very large handwritten and article books that I put together. Not published or nothing, it's just notes, basically. And I had a whole bag of my UFO and abduction material stolen. It was on base, so I have no idea where it went or who took it. It just disappeared. But my second UFO encounter was, I think, a year later. Still in Illesheim, but we lived in a little town called Bad Vinsheim. And something drew me to the porch, or the patio. And I went out, I took a flashlight, and there was a star that kept flashing at me. So I flashed the flashlight back at it. And it was weird, because it shot down towards me, and it hovered about the level of what an airline would be. And I don't recall any telepathic communication, nothing like that. It was nothing significant. It was just one of those strange experiences. And it hovered there for about 10 minutes, and then it shot back up where its point of origin was and flashed at me. And my third encounter was in Iraq. And, okay, going back to the pagan group that I ran, we got treated better by Muslims for being pagan than we did by our own military. And so we had the Turkish Special Forces. They lived by our compound, and they kept going back and forth, you know, because our shower point was by my chew. And one night, two of them came over, and they're like, we noticed you guys sitting here drinking coffee every night. What are you doing? And we explained we're a pagan group. That intrigued the hell out of them, because most Muslims think of America as being a Christian nation. So when they find out there is a non-Christian that's in the Western, you know, civilization, they get intrigued. And they came every night until they left. So within our pagan group, we had several helicopter mechanics, air crews, things of that nature. And for about three nights, we saw these lights in the sky. And bear in mind that if you're not familiar with Iraq, Kalafar is right at the corner of Syria, Iraq, and Turkey. And this series of lights, it was triangular shaped, and it had blue and green lights, if I remember right. I had a video of it, but the video is gone. And every night, it would hover. It wasn't a drone. Even our aircraft mechanics could vouch that it wasn't one of ours. Was it an experimental craft? It could have been. I'm not denying that fact. But it's still an unidentified flying craft.
Right.
So, and it moved. It didn't just hover. Because I tried to rule out any kind of, you know, mundane experience, explanation.
Yeah.
And no, it moved into Syria.
So, did you have anything to do with MUFON?
I was a MUFON investigator for about a year. I wasn't impressed. Because this was back in the 90s, and to me, from what I saw of MUFON, was more a bunch of debunkers. And basically to make the experiencer look stupid. That was my experience with MUFON.
That sounds about like what I've heard about MUFON.
Well, today, and there's a lot of MUFON people that will try to dispute this and say it's BS and you're slandering them and whatnot. But I watched Jesse Ventura's Conspiracy Theory for a while. I kind of liked that show when it was on. But the Bigelow Industries took over the UFO investigating field for the government. I'm sure Blue Book is still around. If it didn't pass off to Bigelow. Bigelow Industries, if you're not aware, also owns Skinwalker Ranch, which is in Utah.
Yeah.
And they pretty much own MUFON. So, do I trust MUFON? Not really. I don't work with them. We do our own investigations. We've got radiation detection equipment. We've got all the equipment we need. When it comes to a haunting, when it comes to a regular paranormal investigation, I don't have high-tech gear. All I use is a basic EMF meter, a basic digital recorder, a cheapie for EVPs, and I use mediums. I rely heavily on mediums. I also have a degree scientist on my team. He's out of North Carolina. But if I need anything sampled or anything like that, I can mail it off to him.
Cool.
Because you see a lot of these paranormal groups that we're in it for the science, and we get into this discussion a lot, but science of what? Do you have a degree? Well, no. Well, then how are you in it for the science? And I know I checked you out. I know you're a physiologist.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I believe in the balance of psychics and science. You can't have one without the other. You can't have a good investigation. The main time you need radiation equipment is for a UFO landing case, which that's very rare. Or if you have a portal, because if you have a portal or a vortex, something of that nature, you can usually pick up a radiation signature.
Right. Other than that, you don't need that sort of thing. Myself, I just use a digital recorder or a laptop or something.
And exactly.
And my stage mic.
I do have a dual digital thermometer readout. It's a laser, and it's got two readings. So if there's a fluctuation in temperature between, you know, through a room, it'll show up.
Yeah.
But you don't need high tech gear. I had my first encounter on another show that I'm on with a spirit box. That was kind of cool.
Did those things, you know, actually work?
Huh?
Do they actually work?
They do. Oh my God, they actually work. I can attest to that because he was on the show doing a live spirit box session. And I asked him, you know, because it was another live chat. And what a spirit box does is it goes through hundreds of frequencies so fast you can't even pick up anything off the radio stations or anything like that. It's a straight fluctuation of frequencies for the spirits to talk through. And I asked him, you know, I want to hear from my grandmother. And sure enough, through the spirit box, two different people attested that they, my mate included, heard through the spirit box, "I'm fine, Aaron." There's no way you can fake that.
No, there isn't. That okay. That's cool.
I got confused. I got confused between that and there's another, I don't remember the name of the box, but it's got like 10,000 words that are, you know, programmed into it. And supposedly the spirit uses those 10,000 words to talk to you. I have a hard time with that one.
Well, yeah, because it's, to me, it kind of like it, the static. They use the energy of the static to talk through or something. And I'm not really sure how it worked because I got Class A EVPs off of my computer and there was no static. So,
right.
You know, I mean, and Amanda, yeah, you have the, Amanda's got a question about how do you feel about SETI, but.
Okay, I see the question now.
Yeah,
how do you feel about SETI? I think SETI's a scam. I really do.
I've always thought SETI was a scam.
Because we have enough, there's enough, if everyone got together, there's enough evidence out there to prove beyond a doubt. Why does the Vatican have its own its own Hubble telescope? You know?
I wasn't aware that they did.
They do. They call it Lucifer. Ain't that, you know, ain't that ironic? Yeah, the Vatican is also heavily into the search for extraterrestrial life, even though the Vatican, or what's his name?
Well, how do you feel about NASA, she asks. Amanda asks.
But, yeah, and NASA, NASA's still up there. You know, I don't know a whole lot about it. I haven't researched it. But, you know, we've got our own super secret space program going on. I have no doubt there's bases on the dark side of the moon, because listen to Neil Armstrong, where they messed up when he was on the moon, and he was saying we're not alone, and then they cut him off. I mean, we've got astronauts, for crying out loud, that came out and said the government's hiding of aliens are here. People, wake up!
Yes,
aliens are here.
I tell people that all the time that they're here. And as far as, I don't know, I believe that we went to the moon, just not on the times that we made it public. I don't buy that.
No, my problem was that the flag wouldn't be waving on the moon.
Well, for one, they've changed everything to color now, so people don't remember it. But the base of the part of the ship that landed on the moon was gold,
right.
And the rest of everything else was in black and white. And this is the first time you see it aired on TV. It's gold. It's like, how can this be when it's colored black and white TV? Because most of us didn't even have color TVs at the time. And I think that's what they were counting on. But people go, oh, well, you know, and they just would tell me I'm stupid or something.
Right. Hold on, Danny wanted to know something, or Danny said something. We need to MUFON. Okay, yeah. Let me go back to the temperature change real quick. Now, I don't compare rooms. I compare. It gives me a reading. The top line is the baseline. The top number is the baseline, and if there's a fluctuation or a cold spot or a hot spot, the second number will show that up. So it's done in the same room.
Okay.
Because she asked about checking the temperature in different rooms to compare. No, I'm not worried about different rooms, although that is something to look at, yes. But what my thermometer does, it shoots a laser across the room, and if there's a variation in difference between temperatures, it will show up on my reading.
Well, with me, if I walk into a room and I find a cold spot because I've got my hair standing up and goosebumps, then I know there's a temperature change, you know. So I never worried about that. But then I'm told I'm tight and I won't spend money on anything. So
exactly. And if you have a feeling there's something there, there probably is.
Mm-hmm.
Go by your gut. It's called intuition.
Yeah.
That's your biggest tool right there, is intuition.
Yeah. Always trust yourself. Trust your gut. You know, don't trust
now,
your head, trust your gut.
If you're interested in my show, I do a Sunday night show from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. Pacific Standard Time on Spreaker. It's called S4 with E squared. Originally, we had a show called the Area 51 Cafe. That's dissolved, but S4 is still going on. The reason I call the show S4 is because I focus on UFOs, aliens, conspiracies. S4, if you're not familiar with Area 51, is a bunker within S4, and that's where all the alien bodies are supposed to be and whatnot. We're E-squared because it's myself, Eric Cooper, and Eric Markham, who's the Spaced Out Radio Newswire guy, and he's the scientist in our group. So because we're both named Eric, it's E-squared. That's where we came up with the name. And again, we cover everything from UFOs, aliens, conspiracies. That's our main focus. We did Illuminati two weeks ago. Last week, we did 9-11. 9-11, we didn't cover the conspiracy aspect because that's overplayed, I think. I think everyone talks about the conspiracy. We talked more about where we were on 9-11 and basically about the government and their involvement with Iraq, which some of it I covered on this show. The rest, you can listen to S4. It is archived. Just go on Spreaker, or look for the links on Forest Moon Paranormal.
There's something I want to talk to you about. It's Spreaker.
Okay.
What is different between what I do and doing Spreaker?
Nothing.
The only difference
is you are an actual 24/7 radio show with music and whatnot. Whereas Spreaker, I pay $19.99 a month, and I can do a 3-hour show consecutive, and it's live, and we have a chat room through Spreaker.
Cool. I pay less, but if that's how you're comfortable,
We've only been doing this for about a month and a half. We've only got like 6 episodes up there. So we're new to this.
Oh, you're new to Spreaker. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's cool. There's some publicity to get you out there.
I'm new to radio because I'm actually a guest co-host on Spaced Out Radio quite frequently. Anytime Dave Scott owned that, I don't want to take away from your show at all.
You're not. That's why you're here. Didn't you say you're part of a pagan radio station too?
No. Spaced Out Radio is all paranormal. And he's on every night from 9 to midnight Pacific Standard Time. He's at British Columbia. He's one of our Paracon speakers as well. He's talking about experiencers and what they go through and things like that. And just real quick, back to the Paracon, we also have Christina George from California coming up, and she's talking about paranormal connections and how they're all connected, whether it's ufology, whether it's hauntings. Paranormal is paranormal.
Yeah.
That's another thing that irritates the hell out of me, is all these people that you say paranormal, they automatically go to the spirit haunt. Never mind that there's alien abductees out there going through hell, and, you know, Bigfoot sightings, and it's all connected.
Right.
You even get that fight with ufologists. Well, we're not paranormal, it's ufology. No, it is. It's paranormal. It's anything out of the ordinary is paranormal. Is a UFO sighting normal? No. Is an alien abduction normal? No,
no,
it's not. It's a crisis. And so we can help people that are being haunted. How do you help an abductee? The best way I can help an abductee is by letting them know, one, that they're not alone. Two, letting them know they're not crazy. Because I don't know how to fight an alien from an abductee. I know you and I talked, and you found a way. I'm not familiar with a way to stop an abduction. But I can also refer them to a peer support abduction group, which I know Deborah, I think, not sure if she still runs one in Seattle or not. I know they're around. And so I can find an abduction peer support group for abductees. And that's how I help them, because I don't know how to stop them.
Well, dragons. You know where I'm going with that?
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't. I can talk to you off air about it. I'm kind of like, I don't want to discuss the hocus pocus side of exactly how you take care of some stuff like that to keep them from coming. And right. You know what I did with the magnets and disabling.
Yeah, and that's the first I've heard of that.
Well, I didn't know what else to do. This was back in the 90s still, man, when I did this.
Exactly. Exactly.
So I just said, okay, well, you know, it's
a frequency-ridden device. So running a high-powered magnet over it makes sense.
Yeah. The magnet, I mean, unless you got a metal plate in your head, then you don't want to do that.
Right.
You know, the other thing I can think of that might have done a trick other than the magnet was going and getting a CAT scan.
Yeah, I could see that too. It ripped it right out.
Oh, did my head hurt so bad then? And I thought my third eye was stuff with my third eye. I thought that's what was going on.
Right.
You know, and I had to get out of that CAT scan. I pissed them off, and because I was moving, and it's like, dude, don't move. And it's like, I can't help it. It hurts. It's not supposed to hurt. You're full of crap. You know.
Yeah.
So
until this little thing comes out. But yeah, that's Florida's Moon Paranormal in a nutshell. Like I said, if you're in Washington State, we are having a Paracon October 22nd. It was going to be a two-day, but we're having issues with our community. With one person in the community that our venue got shot down. So we're switching venues or locations for it. Still going to be up here in Concrete. But we've cut some speakers out, and we're making it a one-day, which didn't affect nothing because we're still covering all the topics we wanted to cover anyway. And all right. Then it's going to midnight because from 8 to 11, we're having a VIP roundtable. And all the speakers are going to sit in one room. I'm going to ask the panel questions as well as answer them. And for $25, 25 people can get tickets to that. And that gives them, you know, VIP privilege. They can find, if they want tickets to it, if they're going to go, they can find that again on the Forest Moon Paranormal.
Now, you were in Washington, right? Washington State?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
So it would be pointless for me to want to go because I couldn't get there conventionally anyway.
Right. And Spaced Out Radio, I believe, is going to be aired live. Again, I'm a guest co-host on there. Anytime he has a paranormal group or UFO alien topics, and the guest only goes 2 hours instead of three, then I usually fill in the last hour with them.
I have a paranormal group that comes in here, and they've been on the show several times, the Bronxville Paranormal, and they're out of New York State, and they have done some stuff with Nuclear Lake, and they do other stuff with, and they actually have a psychic that works with them, and they stepped into the moment, didn't realize it, and they had an encounter with Bigfoot, didn't really realize it till after the fact, and they saw fairies and didn't understand that that's what they were.
Right.
You know, they're a good bunch of, good group of guys, so. And there's somebody else involved on another network, and so I haven't heard from them in a while. It's time to get back in touch with them, maybe.
Right. Well, he's real good about vetting, because he stopped having paranormal groups until he met me, and then saw that we actually help people versus run or take pictures and run, and was impressed, and so he's we're an affiliate of his now. Since, let's see, I want to say March or April when I found Spaced Out Radio. But, yeah, getting to, that's just, it's a hot topic with me, is these paranormal groups that all they want to do is get that picture in, get that network, get that spot on TV.
They just want the attention. That's all they want.
They want to be the first ones in the field to prove that there's no proving it. We all know they're here. And yeah, it irritates me because we want to clean up their mess all the time.
Well, you know, cleaning up people's mess, it kind of, that's the way it is in this country anymore. No one takes responsibility. Everybody wants to just do what they do, and they don't worry about the outcome.
Right. Now on that note, too, a good portion of our team is veterans. And I get asked, don't you get scared? Not really. I've been to four combat tours, and most veterans will tell you, your fear factor and your understanding of life is different after combat. So when it comes to the paranormal, honestly, I can't tell you what scares me because I've never encountered what scared me, because my fear factor is different.
Yeah, I imagine it is. I think that's just a stupid duh that, yes, there's no doubt that your fear factor is different. And
I had a question. A sniper take a shot at me, and luckily he missed, and that was in Somalia. And this bullet passed within inches of mine and my buddy's waist. And I mean, I've been shot at probably without even realizing more times than we had bullets in our ambulances. And to my knowledge, even the UN regulations, you don't shoot at a Red Cross. Well, a Red Cross for most third world countries is a target. So we have bullets in our ambulances, so I couldn't tell you how many times I've probably come close to death and didn't realize it.
Well, the question I have is, do you just not let it affect you at the time that it's taking place and just do what you got to do and think about it later?
That's where the adrenaline factor comes from. That's where the PTSD kicks you in the ass later.
Well, all right. Well, what? Yeah, the PT. Yeah, when it comes time that you come home, and no, I'm not going to ask you to go through this because I already know you don't want to. Except right. I do want to ask, how do you deal with the fact that you have the okay to do what you got to do at one point, and then you come back here and you see all this disrespect going on and all this stuff that people would have got shot for on the other side of the world, that they just walk away and nothing, you know, they get slapped on the hand or nothing happens. How do you deal with that?
You know what pisses me off more is stolen valor. And they passed a law that people can wear our medals and wear, you know, our stuff that we earned and fought for. And that was through the Obama administration. He did it, and yeah, it does anger me.
That would piss me off too, because that's just for you guys. How the hell can they say it's okay for somebody else to wear it? That's like me walking around with a badge.
If I let everything anger me, I'd be out shooting people.
And people wonder why people go out and shoot people. Yeah.
Right. And so I just try not to. I just focus on what I need to focus on. And right now I'm in school for Homeland Security, basically because I want to know what the enemy is and what they know.
Okay.
Homeland Security. As funny as that might sound, but Homeland Security to me is a farce. In a way of manipulating and scaring people.
Yeah.
And most of what Homeland Security teaches, I already know from the military, because I've already taken terrorism and counterterrorism training in the military. Even being a medic, they still teach you today terrorism, counterterrorism, explosives to a degree, not how to make a bomb, but or even how to disable one, but how to identify one. We've actually had recently as of 2009, they're actually teaching us human trafficking, or how to identify human traffickers, or people that have been trafficked. I mean, so you think combat medic, you think mechanic, but there's a lot more training that we get in the military than just our specialty.
It seems to me you would need to have that. It seems to me you would need to have that.
Yeah. And you know, there's a big difference in the military today than there was back in 90 when I joined. I mean, I technically joined in of 89, but I don't count that because I didn't get actual training until, you know, 90. But yeah, there's a very large difference. We don't focus on the jungle anymore. We focus on desert because that's where we're going. That's where everything that goes on is.
What about this crap with North Korea? This crap.
Are they going to launch a missile? I don't know. Is there anything I can do to stop it? No. So I don't dwell on it.
Well, that's all you can do is not dwell on it.
Exactly, and that's why I don't watch news. That's why I don't. I'm not. What I do for my community is I run a community group on Facebook as well, and I do a lot of emergency management information on my community group. I push out flood watches. When the winter comes, we get heavy snows. We get a lot of stupid drivers up here. We have elk that walk across the highway and people hit them. So I listen to a scanner. I report emergency situations that you might want to go on this road instead of that road because that's going on, you know, that kind of stuff. We live next to a volcano, so I push volcano information, earthquake information, things like that. So I do a lot for this community besides paranormal.
Okay.
Like I said, I'm with 4x4 Search and Rescue because that's what I know.
I know mountains. Eric? It's been a pleasure to have you here, dude. We are at the top of the hour. The show is over. So give out your website
you
and stuff,
me.
Man. Give out your website one more time. Huh?
It's been a pleasure.
It's been a pleasure. Give out your website and how to get in contact with you, and then we got to go bye-bye.
All right. Look for Forest Moon Paranormal or Forest Moon Grove if you're pegging on Facebook. My email is medicineeagle@yahoo.com. It's medicine_eagle@yahoo.com if you want to contact me directly. And if you're in Washington State, just look us up.
All right, coolies. You have a good night, buddy. I'll see you. Bye.
Hey, you too. Bye.
All right, guys. Now, I know it was a good show. I know it was kind of slow, but, you know, and sometimes it's that way. It was a good show, a lot of information. And next week, it will be more of the same kind of good show, man. So until next time, y'all have a good one. Take care, be well, be safe. And I will see you. Bye.